Have you ever had a Sunday morning when you felt like sleeping in? Barely got time to get to church for the service begins. You fight off the temptation to just stay home in bed. When you hear the music playing, it ain't the Lord your day. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
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 Preach that sermon, preacher, and bless us with your word. Lift us up with Spirit's wisdom like we never heard. There is just one presence, and it's strong in us today. In this place of unity, to learn to share the praise. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
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 There's a mighty power in that little word. But don't be shy, testify to the truth. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
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 When you feel your burden is more than you can bear, never underestimate the power of prayer. Faith can move a mountain, a calm and angry sea. There's no limits that we know, as long as we believe. There is just one power,
amen,
and one presence too.
Amen.
It's inside of me,
amen,
it's inside of you.
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Can I get amen?
Amen?
Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Can I get amen?
Amen?
Can I get an amen? Welcome.
Welcome to Unity of Little Rock. Good to see all you faces and have you here today. Good to be here today. I moved recently, so it's been 3 or 4 weeks since I've been here. I'm happy to be here myself. So thank you all for coming. And are there any new people here today? Then welcome, and I hope you're prepared for a wonderful service with Amanda. Let me introduce Pat, who's our chaplain today, and will be doing the opening prayer.
Good morning. As third chaplains, we are here to pray with you, or with you as you pray for others. Our prayer box is here, and our slips, if you wish to put someone's name on them, place them in the prayer box. We pray with those names, and then those names are forwarded to Silent Unity. We're also available after service here if you'd like to come and ask a special prayer. I just wanted to make you all comfortable and know that there are several prayer chaplains here this morning, and any of us would be happy to share with you. Our prayer chaplaincy is growing and growing, so we are welcoming more and more prayer chaplains, and we are here to serve you. And right now is our time to start with our opening prayer of awareness of who we are. So as you get comfortable in your seats this morning, and you turn within to that special place that is where you go to we recognize your oneness with the Christ. Breathe in and then exhale. The process of breathing in and breathing out is our time of releasing. We release thoughts that are of dis-ease or inharmony. The breathing in and the breathing out is our connection to the flow of life energy within us. Feel that flow in your body. Feel the consciousness, the oneness, the connection to all that are here. We are all filled with the capacity for good, and we choose to look for that good in every moment, in everyone we meet. We celebrate our oneness of consciousness, and we are blessed with the assurance of love, comfort, hope, and courage, health, and fear. We join together in our home of spiritual oneness. All we have to do is open the door of that awareness. Our home is wherever we are, or wherever our loved ones may be. We give thanks for all our blessings, home, and family. And we extend that oneness of blessing for all of our extended families, wherever they may be. We give in love. We receive in joy. We open the door of gratitude. We join together in oneness of consciousness. Let's hold hands as we join together and not disagree.
Stand up and hug and greet each other and smile at each other, look each other in the eye and say, I'm so glad you're here.
Settle back into our seats if you would stay standing for this next song. Help us sing this as we get ready for Thanksgiving. This is a Thursday, you know, that's coming up, and I thought this song would be appropriate about thank you for this day.
This healing day, this healing.
this awareness of our Christ nature within, in spirit, let us affirm our statement of being together. I am an individualized expression of God. I am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect presence.
You all know this one. So feel free to sing along.
There is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, and let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
Good morning, everyone. I'm so glad that you all are here today and that you could join us in that song that has so much meaning to me. Actually, it was kind of hard for me not to cry when I was singing that today because, you know, we sing it all the time. We all know the words. But it had particular meaning today because, for me, the holidays are such a mixture of celebration and exaltation, but also grief. And, you know, it's the darkest time of the year. And it's a time of intense contrast. And the contrast emphasizes the beauty and the joy, and it also emphasizes the shadow side of the holidays. So let me see if I want to flip back to it. There was a particular line that really got to me today. Because I've been trying to figure out what this talk has been about for like 2 weeks, okay. I did it last week in Hot Springs, and it's going to be a very different talk today. You all might have noticed that I don't have any slides today, and I'm not going to use any notes. because I want to speak very honestly and directly to you. And it may not be smooth, it may not be coherent, but it will be from my heart. Thank you. You know, the reason that line got to me today is because, you know, it's the weekend before Thanksgiving. We're going to talk about gratitude. And gratitude has always been an intense challenge for me. Ma, it's okay. I don't know. My mother is trying to talk to me from the audience. You're asking what line it is. Okay, I'm going to tell you, I promise. I'm not going to forget that part. Okay? Okay. Let it be. This is what happens. Now, I kind of know how Jesus felt at that wedding, you know. It's not my time, Ma. Oh, it's okay, Jesus. You know, I just had to tell your father that I was pregnant and had to convince him that it was an immaculate conception. But it's okay. White or red wine, Ma. So, I guess I'll go straight to that part since my mom so wants to know. The line that got to me today was that, and though the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow. Because for me, my greatest block to gratitude, you know, because I've actually talked about it with a lot of members of this community. I talked to Phil and Tam and the music team, Mary Jane, Chris, and just anybody I could find, my mother, about what blocks gratitude. Because that is something that I have struggled with. It's not that I'm not aware of the joys in my life. It's just that it's hard for me to accept things as they are because there's things that just aren't right in the world. And I think we all feel that way about certain things. And shine until tomorrow. Whenever I experience joy and happiness, the first thing I feel is relief. I'm so glad. I'm so happy that I'm happy. I've been working at it. I've been going to church. I even started preaching in church. You know, I've been trying to find that happiness. And when it actually hits, which isn't as often as I would like, I am so relieved and thankful. I do feel gratitude in that moment. But then I start to feel very afraid because I'm scared that it's going to go away. I'm scared that it's going to be taken from me. I'm scared that it'll stop. I'm scared that I'm going to start feeling depressed again. And so when it said shine until tomorrow, it was just this prayer, please, please let this light stay. Let this light fill me and let it stay. Let me be able to continue in this moment of joy and gratitude. And I don't know. It's like, I think that's partly how depression works, is that fear of the disappointment of the loss of that happiness becomes a block to it. One of my favorite poems in college is a Shakespeare sonnet, and the very end of it is, this thought is as a death which cannot choose, but to weep to have that which it seems to lose. And I spend a lot of my time, and I've spent a lot of my life, even as a kid, kind of a mourning transient, being afraid of what's going to happen in the future, and being so scared that this joy that's in my hands now is going to slip through like sin. And Unity teaches that, you know, there's this, you know, law of mind action, because part of the lesson of Job. Job says, you know, what I fear I brought about, it's not exactly what he said, but it's my paraphrase. My fears have come true, basically. And so there's a sense in which what we expect to see is what we see in the world. You know, I'm fearful, and I'm thinking that I'm going to lose my happiness, and then it happens, because that's kind of what I'm expecting, and that's what I'm paying attention to. And so the first thing that comes along that might, you know, take my gratitude, take my happiness, it does, because that's what I'm looking for. And that is partially true. But there's also things that do work on us in an external way that are really challenging to overcome, like chronic pain and the loss of a loved one. So I don't think it's, there's no simple metaphysical solution, because even though I put in a lot of work into meditating and different things, the mental discipline, but you know, happiness still sneaks up on me. It still sneaks up on me. I can do all this stuff. I can jump through flaming hoops. And this morning, I woke up very depressed. And then I read a passage in Emily Tatey, because I was going to justify or help validate why I wasn't using a book today, or notes today, with an actual book. So I want you all to feel the irony / hypocrisy of that for a minute. And I just felt so happy, because what inspires me about Emily Tatey is that I think she had a similar approach to me in her spiritual growth. What she would do, she was trying to prove spiritual principles. She would take something and she would practice it, and she wouldn't always do well at first. She suffered incredibly to produce those writings. I mean, she told Charles Fillmore that these were born of the travails of my soul. And she couldn't bear to see them changed, because she really suffered a lot. I mean, she wanted to prove that she didn't have to accept money for her healing practice, and that God would provide. Well, she was very hungry a lot of the time. And she wanted to, her father was falsely imprisoned for 5 years. And she worked very hard to help change that situation, change the way that she thought about it. So Emily Tatey, in some ways, is like a spiritual scientist. She has a hypothesis, and then she tries to demonstrate it. And that's kind of what all of us are doing. We're all spiritual scientists, in a way. We have our truth, or something that we believe to be true, and we try to practice it. And then we share the results. And that's always how I've done my talks. I'm trying to learn from the universe. I'm trying to learn from everybody here. And one thing that Emily Tatey says that really does ring true today, at least for me. She says, my advice, if you want to make rapid progress and growth towards spiritual understanding, stop reading many books. She says in her book. They only give you someone's opinion about truth, or a sort of history of the author's experience in seeking truth. What you want is revelation of truth in your own soul, and that will never come through the reading of many books. The very spirit of truth is at your call, within you. Wait patiently for it to guide you into all the truth about all things. How will you know? You will know just as you know that you are alive. All the argument in the world to convince you against truth that comes to you through direct revelation will fall flat and harmless at your side. And the truth that you know, not simply believe, you can use to help others. That which comes forth through your spirit will reach the very innermost spirit of him to whom you speak. And that, it gives me so much hope that exploring the truth within us can be of service to others. Because gratitude is actually defined as a social action and emotion. Gratitude consists of the appreciation of a good that you have received, acknowledging that there is good in your life, and that it came to you in part from an external source. And so gratitude is about helping us connect with something that is greater than ourselves. It's a way of us all bonding together. Now, there is a positive psychologist by the name of Dr. Emmons. I think it's Robert Emmons. It might be good. And he said it's impossible to feel gratitude toward yourself, that it has to be something external to you. And I don't agree with that, because I think that we can feel gratitude to ourselves for showing up every day, waking up and getting out of bed, you know, speaking to other people with a smile on our face. And we can feel gratitude for those moments of darkness, of contrast, of struggling to get out of bed and talk to people and trying to, you know, smiling with your mouth but not with your eyes. And everybody can tell, but they're trying to give you the benefit of the doubt because it's so hard for us all to go there, and we're trying not to. But sometimes we have to give in. Another one of my favorite stories about Jesus is Lazarus. Lazarus passed. Jesus received word that Lazarus was sick, and he didn't go right away. He waited. He said, I'll go tomorrow. And how many of us have done that? I'll go tomorrow. And as he's coming, I think it was Mary, Lazarus' sister, who came to him with tears in her eyes and said, it's too late. He's gone. And Jesus at that point didn't say, it's okay. You know, we're all one, and I can bring him back. Just like that. He saw the grief in Mary. He saw the grief in Lazarus' family. And Jesus wept. He let all of that resistance to what was go. And he shared in the grief of everyone around him. He still brought Lazarus back from the grave, or their son said. There was still joy, but in order for that joy and that, you know, the first resurrection to happen, we have to be willing to give in to those feelings of loss and grief and the things that bubble up that are blocking us from the truth of who we are. And I'm actually really grateful for that story. It really taps into that humanity where we're just hoping that the good we have now is still going to be here tomorrow. And we act in faith as though it will. And sometimes it does. And there is always good. There's always good all the time. It's not always the good that we wanted. It's not always the good that we would have chosen. And there's always something to be grateful for. But sometimes we use gratitude like a case against the feelings that we're having now. Like, okay, well, you know, Amanda, your back hurts, but, you know, there's people in a lot worse situations, and, you know, your father passed away, but you still have your mother, and you have a hard time eating, but you still have a lot to eat, and there are people who don't have anything to eat at all. And, you know, the comparison has never really, I don't know people. There might be some people who feel gratitude instantly when somebody, you know, kind of chastises them like that. Like, no, there's food on your plate, you're fine. But most of us feel, yeah, well, most of us feel guilty. It's like, not only am I ungrateful, I'm also guilty. because I shouldn't be feeling this way. It's a form of invalidating. And validation, by definition, is acknowledging that somebody's experience is understandable and that it makes sense. And invalidation is saying, I don't make sense. This, I shouldn't feel this way. If I could just do this simple thing, then it would be better. And that is not true. It's not necessarily true. So there's a point at which we validate. It's a paradox, see? It's an ironic thing, if I'm using the word irony correctly. By validating whatever we're experiencing and saying, yes, this is my experience and I accept it, at the same time, we come to a place of acceptance and peace that cannot be validated, that is beyond understanding. I have another quote here from the Bible, from Philippians, on my phone. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, metaphysically, Christ is the energy of basically enlightenment, of the inner divinity within all of us. Now, y'all may have noticed here that validation is about something that is understandable. And this is peace that transcends understanding. So this peace cannot be validated. And it cannot be invalidated. You know, there's that's when those moments of happiness sneaking up on me. It's kind of like I've met people in situations where I don't know how they're happy. I know people who are in chronic pain every day, and they show up with a smile on their face, and they help just lift the world. I'm like, how? How is that even possible? And then there are times when I've just been having the worst day and just the worst time, and it feels like I haven't smiled in a week, and then all of a sudden, it's like the sun rises inside of me, and I can just feel joy. I'm like, how? And that is just the grace and the beauty that I think keeps us all here. I think that is the piece that is beyond understanding. And there's things that we can do to help that come along. But ultimately, you know, it's kind of like just seeing what's around the corner. It may be there, it may not. But it's worth it. It's worth it to run into it, be like, oh. I tell you, the last time, one of the times that I felt it recently was you know, I'm allergic to a lot of stuff, y'all. And I found out that I could eat the fries at Chick-fil-A. And I went to Chick-fil-A and I got some of the waffle fries. And I was so happy. Every time I eat waffle fries at Chick-fil-A, I feel very privileged. That's all it took. I'm like, after this whole edifice of reasons and justifications and just whatever experience and memories and loss that I've been carrying around, it took so little to make me happy. I was so easily pleased. And just trust yourself. That's really what this talk is actually about. The talk is about trust. The talk is about trusting that there still is joy inside of you that will sneak up on you, that can come up, and eventually you can call it, I've been told. You'd ask some of the people that you see here who are able to carry that happiness with them all the time. But trust that it is there. It's like spiritual object permanence. It's one of my favorite, I talked about that a while back. You know, there's a babies up till a certain age do not realize that things exist if they can't see them. When baby's mother leaves the room, they just lose it because if they can't see her, she doesn't exist. And when they get to a certain age, they realize that when mom leaves the room, she still exists. She's still there. And we do the same thing with our relationship to spirit and spirituality. I can feel connected with all of you and with everything and really feel the reality of spirit. And then I get knocked down and I start crying because mama left the room and I'm not sure if she's really there anymore. So if I can reach the developmental age of two in my spirituality, then that really will be a huge accomplishment. But trust, and this has been the hardest lesson of my whole life, because I want to be able, when I have happiness in my hands, to trust that I can enjoy it. And then when it's gone, to trust that I will have it again in a different form, and that it's okay. It's okay for things to be changing. It's okay for life to change. It's okay for us to get older and for new things to happen. Even though it kind of doesn't feel that way. And I haven't really gotten over it yet. So as a practice, this Thanksgiving, give in. Give in to the feelings that you have. Give in to the joy. Because because every time you do that, you're also giving to yourself, and you're showing gratitude and validation for your experience, which is priceless. But you don't know, by speaking from your heart, whatever's in there, you could be touching someone, you could be helping someone. And Brene Brown defines spirituality as feeling connected to something greater than ourselves. But I think it's also seeing ourselves in all things. The self becomes, the limits of the self break down, and it encompasses everyone. It encompasses everything. So, thank you all. You all help give my life meaning every day. So thank you. So before we start meditation, I'd like you all to join us. You may know this prayer by Karen Drucker. You can sing it meditatively so that everyone can get there. We'll have meditation in the middle of it, and we'll finish it together. So this is the morning prayer by Karen Drucker.
I will surrender to my greatest, highest good. I will release any fear that blocks my way. For every step I take is taken in pure faith. And I am stronger every moment. And my heart is open wide. I trust my instinct and let spirit be my guide. I vow to live a life that's real and pure and free. As I continue walking in this mystery, I will surrender to my greatest, highest good. I will release any fear that blocks my way. For every step I take is taken in your faith, and I am grateful every moment, every day.
I invite you all to relax, to breathe deeply. And as we settle into this moment, we realize that we only have to live 1 second at a time. Letting go of all the thoughts that limit us, of the ghosts, of the past. Continue to play through our minds and make us feel like we're living in two
the joy that is within us and the promise of joy around us. Joy that we can help birth into being just by being who we are. Without needing to change, without needing to be perfect, without having to have perfect Thanksgiving and perfect Christmas. Every day, your presence, your love, your attention, and your focus is the greatest gift. We continue to sing this prayer and give into the joys of this song.
There may be walls, there may be roadblocks in my way, but I can choose to take a higher path each day. And I know that what I thought was safe and sound was only habit and regret that held me down. I will surrender to my greatest, highest good. I will release that blocks my way. For every step I take is taken in pure faith, and I am kinder every moment, every day, and I'm more loving every moment, every day. I will surrender every moment, every day.
Thank you.
Now we're going to hand it over to the music team, who's going to wake everybody up.
That's our job. Yeah, I don't know if you were paying attention today, but we were heavy on the Karen Drucker song, the one they just did, and the earlier one, Thank You for This Day. And those are her typical type of songs, just a little simple chant, usually. And I don't know where this next song came from. Maybe she wrote it with somebody that this is not one of her typical songs, but nevertheless, it is a Karen Drucker song. You'll see that it is not typical.
Thank you.
is no spot where God is not. There is no spot where God is not. God is me and God is you. God's in everything we do. There is no spot where God is not. And I know that God is everywhere, in the trees and in the air. And I feel that I have lost my way. I just open my heart and I hear Spirit say, there's no spot where God is not. There's no spot where God is not. God is me and God is you. God's in everything we do, and there is no spot where God is not. No matter what you think or do, God's right here inside of you. And I know that I am not alone. When I rest in God, I know I'm spot. God is not. There is no spot where God is not. God's in me, God's in you. God's in everything we do. There is no spot where God is not. There's no spot. God is not.
There's no spot.
This is our opportunity to give. And when we give, we receive a greater reward. Pressed down, well measured. Every penny we receive, we use to the best of our ability to support the Sunday. Thank you. join me in our blessing. Divine joy as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I give, and all that I receive. Today.
I would like to start by thanking and acknowledging our community for all of these wonderful sacks that have been donated for our Super Sack Sunday that's going to help the van, which is in mobile outreach for the homeless. So thank you so much for that. That's awesome. You know, a couple weeks ago I got headbands for people of color, but we ran out. So guess what? I have placemats. Come and get a placemat to color for Thanksgiving and make sure you take a picture of that. Won't that be awesome?
That'll be awesome.
And then we'll post them in the community room. What do you think of it?
I think that'll be good.
Yeah.
And then we can get Christmas ones for them to do.
Okay. Good. Maybe we'll make paper canes together, too.
And we'll have a tradition.
So there's a spot. Like Cam was saying, there are spots everywhere to put what you're thankful for and your name. So we're going to decorate with that. And we are having Thanksgiving dinner here on Thursday at 2 o'clock. I'm just wondering if, Tina, is there anything else you'd like me to add to that? Or would you like to come and say something? Find in the vestibule, another one of our outreach projects is the Knitting for Noggins, Crocheting for Cranium. is that the right word, cranium? Cerebellums, I've heard cerebellum too. So we have started that collection, and I would like to get them to the hospital the first week in December. So if you could have the first wave here by the 3rd, I've had some people ask me, well, what if I don't knit or crochet? If you'd like to donate one, that would be awesome. We're going to be doing this again in February. You'll have another opportunity to do that.
Should I do the Christmas party? We're going to have a Christmas party December 6th. I believe that's a Wednesday evening. We're still working out some of the details, but we are going to have cards that have been designed, little postcards, that you can give out to people to invite them to join us either at the Christmas party or for our Christmas celebration. It's a wonderful time to introduce people to Unity's version of Christmas and how we celebrate. So that'll be coming up. Anybody who couldn't hear, there is an insert in the bulletin today. And we do need to know if you're coming and what meal you would like because we got food. Believe it or not, folks, it's almost the same. Yeah. Where this year went, I have no clue. But we do need you to respond so that we can have the proper meal ready. Apparently, potluck has been canceled for this month, so I have no idea what I'm going to eat next Sunday.
Thanksgiving leftovers.
Thanksgiving leftovers.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess that'll work.
And also, it is Celebration Sunday. So we're here to celebrate. We'd like to celebrate and acknowledge anyone that's having a life event. We usually call them birthdays, anniversaries, that we could all acknowledge for you. Have one. My grandson turned 2 today. Yes, little Carter is 2 today. And Andre?
I have one. I moved into my new home.
Yay!
Some of you may have missed me for the past few weeks. That's because I was preparing the move. I made the move last Saturday into my new custom-built home so that it's accessible for me. anybody who wants to visit me in Hot Springs and help unpack the rest of the box is welcome.
He's serious. He needs some help.
I'm thrilled to be in my new home. And I do still, I've had a number of people come to me in a kind of panic. I'm not leaving. I still intend to be here fairly regularly. It's just the past few weeks have been a little bit hard to deal with. So I'm back.
I would like to thank and acknowledge Jerry Blake, who has decided to step up and actually be the leader for the hospitality team. And I'd also like to thank the hospitality team, which is Jerry, Pat, and Travis, who always do such an amazing job every Sunday to make everyone feel welcome and to have goodies out. So thank you very much, Jerry, Pat. Really, really appreciate all the effort you put into it. Thank you. And for our community holiday outreach, we are adopting two families to our house. Gary and I will be heading that up. And if you could please see us after service in the community room to adopt either a family member, we have all the details. So please see us in the community room. There are two needy families who would really love our house. So please see us after service. Thank you.
I think we should all form in a circle and hold it.
It's so long, but that's good to see what's going to be.
Let's come down the aisle.
We're going to line up down the aisle. Down the aisle, like we're about to do a little barn dance. Oh, will we make it? Are we going to stretch?